You know, the larger church was silent throughout most of our history when there was slavery. There was a vocal minority that began to urge this kind of moral vision, this faith vision that rejected slavery, but the church was largely silent. The church was largely silent throughout most of the early 20th century when we had racial terrorism in this country, where thousands of people were being lynched.
You know what? I didn't read about that in my history class.
There were people lynched in America from the end of Reconstruction until World War II. Thousands of African Americans were pulled from their homes, sometimes pulled from churches. They were burned alive. They were hanged. They were murdered. They were shot. They were sometimes lynched in the public square with thousands of people, including people who regularly went to church cheering on these acts of violence and terror. It was terrorism. And the church was largely silent. We were largely silent during the 20th century when we had segregation shaping the lives of too many people. People think that the burden of segregation was that people just couldn't do these things, but it was worse than that. My parents were humiliated every day of their lives. Those signs that said white and colored weren't erections, they were assaults. And we were silent. And then a courageous few began to speak against it. And we ended that. And we've been largely silent during this era of mass incarceration. Now, the prison population has gone from 300,000 to 2.3 million. We have the highest rate of incarceration in the world, and we're not ashamed.
And the church, crime do the time, brother?
The church has been silent while we have put children, 13 and 14 years of age, in prison to serve death in prison sentences. We put people in prison for decades for simple possession of marijuana. We treat drug addiction as a crime rather than a disease. We don't do that for alcoholism. And it's been these platitudes, do the crime, do the time. It's been the politics of fear and anger that has allowed this to exist, and we've been largely silent. And so it's exciting to hear a growing community of people of faith saying we have to stop this, we have to challenge this. We are implicated. I don't think the church is judged by the size of the buildings that it creates. I don't think it's judged by how many members we attract. We're not judged by the beauty of our music, the power of our testimony. We are judged by our witness in a world where there's slavery and terrorism and segregation and mass incarceration. What we say in response to that is how we're going to be judged. You know, we read in the scriptures that Jesus condemned those who wanted to throw stones at the adulterous woman. And he made them feel shame and they went away. And he told her, go and sin no more. I think today that scripture is still there. That challenge is still there, not to judge. But people are picking up stones and throwing them left and right. And I think the new church, this church, has to be willing to be stone catchers. We've got to be willing to stand in places where we bear the burden of those who have been wrongly accused and condemned. We bear the burden of those who are being presumptively treated as if they're dangerous or guilty. We have to bear the burden of those disfavored communities in our country and across the world, those religious minorities, those sexual minorities, those undocumented communities, people who are black and brown. We have to bear their burdens. We have to stand up and catch the stones that are cast at them, and then we make a witness. Then we make a statement about our faith that is empowering, that's transformative. And so I'm excited to be among a community of people who are trying to do that. We've got a lot of work to do, but we've been given great tools to do it with. We know something about redemption. We know something about grace. We know something about mercy. We know that we're broken, but our brokenness doesn't define us. It just opens us up to what grace and mercy can do. And that's the secret weapon that I think we have to employ if we're going to confront racial bias and racial inequality in America.